Please let me introduce Jingli. He's a software engineer, and you'll talk about Android meets Docker. Jingli.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name is Jing, and I'm from Berlin, Germany, currently working for no company at the moment. Today, I'm just going to talk about Android meets Docker and what mobile team can benefit from utilizing Docker. Hope it will give you some inspirations. Let's start. Let's start from the developer story. Here is an Android developer. And one day, he got a fancy brand new laptop. And he became super happy about it. He decided to pull his project from GitHub and run it over there. Boom, it failed. Couldn't find Git. Gradle is not in place. No Java. So does AndroidSDK. So frustrating. It's even more pain in the admin. If you think about provisioning tons of different machines for mobile CI form, yeah, later it's just like brain overflow. Not an easy job. I mean, there are tons of different other tools, but not easy. Before I choose Docker as a tool, I'd like to first try to compare different solutions and why we should choose Docker instead of other tools. And here I would like to compare containerization versus virtualization. I guess all of you sitting down here are already expert in Docker or using Docker, so I don't have to talk about details about them, but I just want to emphasize to you the major difference between them. Docker, on the left-hand side, it shares the resources amongst different containers, so it's pretty lightweight. And on the right side hand, it's virtualization. It does good in isolating resources. But in order to do that, it has to have the hypervisor overhead, which is not that lightweight. Which brings to the next chart, why choose Docker? Actually, for mobile CI or for Android CI, we don't really care about the resource isolation. It's not for production. It's only for development purpose inside the team, inside the corporation. And for Android, the Docker-supported OS, Linux, is more than enough. And just imagine for CI, what do you want? When the mobile developer pushes the code to the code repository, which triggers the CI build, he probably wants to get the immediate feedback from the CI. So the boot time matters. And also, the lightweight body size is more than great to have. Now, just imagine we have chosen Docker for Android CI. And is it really working? And now it's time to prove the concept. This tool I would like to introduce is called Infer. It's a tool to detect bugs in Java and many other different languages. It's made by Facebook. And for the ease of use, Facebook use a Docker image, and so you don't have to suffer from the painful installation steps, and you just consume it. So I tried it out. I put my project from the company and run it inside the Docker container provided by Infer. And most of the Android project, in reality, it needs to update the Android SDK. I mean, apart from the default Android SDK you can download from the Android website, because that one is just like a basic one. And most of the project, it requires some certain API level or some additional add-ons or different components from the SDK. So anyway, you just need to update. So I just tried to run the update inside the Docker container provided by Facebook. Unfortunately, it didn't work. And why? because the default file system used by Docker, aka AUFS, it doesn't support the hard link move operations. And the hard link move operations happens when you update the Android SDK. Okay. So what is the solution? You probably think about if the problem is caused by the file system, then let's just use a different file system driver, just like maybe BTRFS. Yes, of course, but there could be an easier way or some other approach which also provides you some other advantages, just like this one I have tried. It's mounting the SDK, the Android SDK volume in container. And the benefits are several. The first one is it's minimal because with image, we just want to keep it small so it can be deployed everywhere. And to prepare the image, we just need to download the standard SDK zip file from Android website. That's it. And it's flexible. You don't have to configure SDK right from the start when you prepare the image. But instead, just imagine if you have different Android projects running in your company, in your mobile team, then probably different Android team, they have a different SDK requirement. So with this flexible way, they just have to maintain their own SDK requirement on their own. And the third one is, in that case, all of the SDK updates, all of the data is persisted on the host disk. So you don't have to waste time download the SDK again and again for each single CI build. And because it's persisted on the host machine, it's not inside the container, you can also share it across different container instances. Speaking of share, I would like to talk about how to share it with NFS and the real performance about it. Of course, sharing with NFS allows you to host the SDK within one place and then consume it from different containers anywhere else. You will probably wonder how good is the performance. I will tell about this later. And also, there is one warning that you shouldn't do the concurrent writing of the Android SDK update. Because if you update from two different instances, then you will just screw the SDK volume up. So the better way is just mount the SDK volume as read-only and have a dedicated job doing the update and mount it as a read and write. It's easier. Okay, so I have tried the benchmark to check the performance of mounting it with NFS and writing it concurrently. On the leftmost, you can see that the bare metal is really optimized. It's, for this sample project, it's just like 40 seconds. The second one is about using Docker plus hosting the SDK volume on your host machine, the same machine where you run the Docker. So it's just local. And it's just like add up 1 second to comparing with the bare metal solution. And the third one is moving the SDK volume from the host machine to a NFS drive. And it's not really a big deal. It's just like 2 seconds more comparing with the host solution. And it's probably due to the network. The last one, I have spinned up two container instances and accessing the some remote NFS SDK volume, and the performance is not bad at all. Like, as you see, the first one is even shorter. I don't know why, probably machine difference. And the other one could be just network I/O slow it down, but it's not really a big deal, just 5 seconds more. Comparing with the bare metal, you can deal with that. Anyway, it's no problem at all. And the I would like to also talk about the performance comparison comparing the on-premises versus some other cloud solutions. Here, I have tried like with a sample project with two build type, debug and release, and with over 100 unit tests, and in total is over 200 and two UI tests, which is the slowest part. And with the on-premises one, with a cached Android SDK from the NFS drive, and without any optimization, it's roughly 6 minutes. And the other one, the other ones with the other online CI solutions, most of them is over 10 minutes, also without optimization. So we have talked about the UI test. That's the slowest part in your daily Android CI job. So here I would like to talk about the Android devices, what kind of solutions we have there. And the first option is available everywhere. It's the ARM emulator. It's available everywhere, but it's slow. And second one, it's optimum. It's x86 emulator. It's lightning fast, but it requires KVM, which means you can only deploy with like a hardware Linux machine. And the third one is USB. It's a physical way, and it needs a privileged mode. It's not a big deal. I mean, as I said before, it's deployed only inside your corporation, and it's for development purpose. It's not for release or production. But also, this one doesn't work for Mac OS X. Why do I want to mention that? Because most of the Android team, they also work together with the iOS team. That's the whole mobile team. And probably the mobile team hosts their CI solution in some macOS, because iOS team need that. That's why I want to mention that. The fourth one is Wi-Fi. Actually, I don't really use that, but I just want to mention that it's another option for you to choose. It's also a physical way. I don't really like physical way, because like the USB one, if you host, if you connect the physical device with the USB, once ADB dies, which is a communication layer between the device and the computer, then you have to manually unplug the device and then connect it again to the PC. The last one is about Jelly Motion Cloud or any other third-party solution, because they are x86 emulator, it's lightning fast, they have a comprehensive API for you to call. And how about the performance? As I said before, ARM emulator is extremely slow. For my two sample UI tests, it takes over 2 minutes. And comparing with the x86 emulators, they just takes less than 1/5 of the time comparing with the ARM emulator. Out of memory, because Android use JVM. So sometimes you can get this overwhelming error messages, just like queued, out of memory, Gradle crashed, something like that. So you could wonder what to do with that and how to differentiate different kinds of error logs. There are tons of different great articles online talking about how to optimize JVM for container and this and that. But here I just want to tell you one technical I have found during investigating all of this. First, JVM is not container aware before JDK 9 or JDK 8.1.3.1 release. You have to use a parameter starting from them to make JVM, make JVM container aware, like the unlock experimental VM options, and also make it aware of the control group memory limit. But here, I just want to simply tell you that there are two different categories. One, it's always depends on the exit code. So if you see 137, it means queued, which means that your container doesn't aware of JVM. Your JVM doesn't aware of container. And so the whole thing, including JVM, is queued by the kernel OOM queueler. And the other one is the positive case. It's the exit code is 1, which means you have tweaked it really well, and it's just like the JVM itself terminates the program and exits. And in that case, you just have to allocate the right memory for your container to consume it. Can we get any better? Of course, Gradle distributions. Gradle is a de facto built for Android. And as the most recent one, the releases, you can see that here, most of them, the distribution is over around 90 megabytes. It's pretty huge. It depends on your network if you don't have a decent one. So I built a Gradle distribution mirror server inside the Docker image. And where is it defined? The Gradle distribution download link was defined in the Gradle wrapper properties inside your Android project. And it looks like just like this. And at the bottom, it's saying something like HTTPS, service.gradle.org, and blah, some version. And it will be downloaded to your user directory, Gradle, wrappers, distributions. And because I created the mirror server completely over HTTP and HTTPS, so you have to also trust the SSL certificate in your Android CI container to make sure that there is no warning or error. And last but not least, you have to modify your etc host to redirect all of the Gradle.org traffic to your Gradle distribution mirror server's IP address. I think the time is running out, but still, can we get any better? Gradle caches. Because Gradle is fetching all of the third-party dependencies, libraries, and et cetera, so don't waste time again downloading dependencies. Just persist it. It's inside the user directory, Gradle caches. And also, the other benefit is it can help review the machine-dependent problems. There are some of them I'd like to share with you. The first one is encoding problem. Like for the international teams, for this case, it seems like the unit test is not saved in the correct UDF-8 format, so the O with umlaut is missing. And also hard-coded time zone. For example, this one, I'm in Berlin, as I mentioned, so my team has the +2 time zone, and running container, you will fail, or if you have any coworker in different places remotely. And also file path, because it's OS dependent values or implementations. And last slide, I want to talk about if there is anything else that you can also bring to your mobile team, like ours. The first one is integration test. In the past, lots of the mobile team just run the integration test against some of the small team, just run the test against the production for just they're a bit lazy. And some of them test against the test server or staging. And the network is unreliable. And also, it's complex setup for the mobile developers. Just also, for example, for the monolith services, you even have to set up the, you even have to tunnel to the database. So it's a pain. And with Docker, for mobile developers, they just have to use it out of the box on any of the local machines. And something else? Nowadays, people are using Kotlin for Android, Swift for iOS, and with this, you can just build the serverless, and you can build the front end, or you can reuse the application code on anywhere. And that's all. Thank you. And you can just find me on GitHub or Twitter. And the Docker image is also available on GitHub. Thanks a lot.